Dear Dad, we thank you so much for making us to be your children. We love you. We invite you in this moment, especially to be with us. We ask that we can sit in your lap and come to you, Father, as the song we're about to sing implies. We know that you will receive us because you say you will, and you say you love us because you love us. We accept that. We embrace that today. In your name we pray. Amen. Weak and wounded sinner.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away. Precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus. Sing to Jesus.
Our next song is called You Are Holy, which is sort of a duet song that we sing. Men and women have different parts, and that's really wonderful for the family of God. We sing each our own song of praise to the Lord, and it's all beautiful. So we have a men's part, which Ed is going to lead us. The men back here will be singing. The ladies' part will be my part. We're sort of a reflecting part. We've done it a little bit here. So if it's familiar, sing loud. If it's not, we'll do it a couple times. You'll figure it out.
Thank you.
Great job. Welcome to worship today. Please be seated.
Morning. There I am. Thought I'd bring a little sunshine with me this morning. I found this yellow dress in the closet, and I thought, what better day for that than today? Welcome to worship today at Road to Emmaus Presbyterian Church, where together we have a heart for the Harrisburg area, and we make new and growing disciples of Jesus Christ. In front of you, in the chair backs, there are a couple of cards. One of them says, welcome, and if you are a visitor with us today, we would urge you to fill in one of these cards so that we can get to know you better and so that we can help you with any needs you may have. And we also see a prayer card in there, and that's in case you don't feel comfortable waving your hand and saying, please pray for me. We collect these, and Pastor Wayne puts them in with our prayers. So know about that. Those of you who are worshiping with us online, welcome. We're glad that you found us. We hope that you'll stay a while. We also hope that you will contact us if we can be of any help or service to you by prayer or by action. We want to do that. To contact us, there is information on the website, to call or to email, and we'll be sure to get back with you just as soon as possible. Dan and I are working our way through reading the Bible in a year, and if you've ever tried to do that, July is kind of like, okay, we caught up a little bit today. But I read this morning. It's very short. It's Psalm 12. Save, O Lord, for the godly one is gone, for the faithful have vanished from among the children of man. Everyone utters lies to his neighbor. With flattering lips and a double heart they speak. May the Lord cut off all flattering lips, the tongue that makes great boasts. Those who say, with our tongue we will prevail, our lips are with us, who is master over us? Because the poor are plundered, because the needy groan, I will now arise, says the Lord. I will place him in the safety for which he longs. The words of the Lord are pure words, like silver refined in a furnace on the ground, purified seven times. You, O Lord, will keep them. You will guard us from this generation forever. On every side the wicked prowl, as vileness is exalted among the children of man. Ripped from the headlines, 2023. What it really means is that God was God then, God is God now, and God will be God in the future. Yes. So please join me in the call to worship. It's in your bulletin and should be on the screen here pretty soon. Once that little arrow quits. There we go. All right. O God, how abundant is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you.
In the power of your presence, you hide them from the plots of men.
Blessed be the Lord, who wondrously showed his steadfast love to me when I was in a besieged city.
I said to my alarm, I am cut off from your sight, but you heard my pleas for mercy when I cried to you.
Love the Lord, all you his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts in pride.
Be strong and let your heart take courage, all of you who wait for the Lord.
Our song is All Glory, Laud, and Honor. It's number 88 in the hymnal in front of you, and please stand.
It's also on the screen.
Oh, King of
We often use our doubts and questions as excuses for irresponsibility, but God calls us to account. We have disobeyed God's word and rejected the one who revealed God's love. When we do not believe, we cannot see the goodness of God. Let us seek God's mercy and forgiveness as we pray our prayer of confession together. Let us pray. Hear the brokenness of our lives, precious God. We cover our ears so we cannot hear the cries of those in need or you urging us to respond. We rush together to defend every issue that matters to us, but quickly disperse when you call us to be your holy nation. We shout as loud as we can to cheer on our sports teams, but can only mute whispers when it comes to sharing the good news. Forgive us, our Judge and King. Do not hold our sins against us. We lay the garments of our foolishness at your feet, so you might clothe us in grace and hope. We would feed on the spiritual food which flows from your word, so we might be strong enough to follow Jesus as he leads us in the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. Let not your hearts be troubled. Whoever believes in God will not be put to shame. When we believe, it will be revealed in the way we live and our care for others. We will do the things that Jesus did to help the people God loves. You are chosen to proclaim the mighty acts of one who called you out of the shadows into his marvelous light. Rejoice, you have received the mercy of God. Let us respond with the words to "You Are My King" should be on the screen.
Amazing love. Amazing love.
our prayer this week. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Father of all humankind, your love for us was revealed in Jesus Christ. As we receive your word today, draw us into a relationship of trust in you that will help us day by day to discern more clearly the way you intend for us. Help us to follow Jesus in all humility and to do the work of Christ without calling attention to ourselves. We long to become that household of mutually caring people that Jesus made us to be. Amen. Our scripture reading is from Exodus chapter 19, first six verses. It's found on page 60 in your red Bible in front of you. On the third new moon, after the people of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the people of Israel, You yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning. He didn't wear his yellow dress. That's the problem.
Let's greet one another in the name of Jesus.
Hi, everybody. We even have some friends with us, some visitors. We have Damien and Job. And Waylon, who is your friend? Hi, Kai. You want to wave? There's a little camera up there. We can wave to the people at home and say, hi, look at all of us having a good time here today. Now, today I brought some sunflowers with me. Do any of you have sunflowers at home? I don't either. I don't have enough sun in my yard. The amazing thing about sunflowers is they will follow the sun throughout the day. Like right there is east, over there, where the big screen is. So it will start in the morning, and it will follow the sun. It goes across the sky till it sets. How does it know that? There's a big scientific explanation I won't get into, but maybe they're wrong. Sometimes science is wrong anyhow. Yep. I'm going to put this on the floor. Let's see here. Okay, yeah. Hold it. So I always like sunflowers because they remind me of one of my favorite verses from the Bible, from John chapter 8, verse 12, that says, yeah, it's kind of picky. It's not very, yeah, it's a little, that's okay. It's a little picky. So the Bible says, Jesus said, I am the light, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. Now, I'm sure everybody knows this flashlight. This flashlight has a really bright light. So when we use a flashlight because it's dark outside or the power goes out, when we walk with it, will we walk like this with the light behind us? No, that would be silly. We certainly would trip and fall. We walk, we follow the light. And that's what Jesus is telling us to do, to follow the light. Jesus was the Son of God, S-O-N, just like sunflowers follow the sun in the sky. Jesus tells us we should follow him, and he will help us and lead us and keep us safe. So that's my message for today. Remember that Jesus says, I am the light, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us so much. You sent your Son, S-O-N, to the earth that we might follow him and eventually live with you forever. And all God's children said, amen.
to hear the word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We ask, Lord, that you would now soften and tune our hearts to receive your word, that we might consider now more and more what it means that we would be men and women, sons and daughters of God, that we would also be in some way a nation that is whose heart is tuned to yours. And so we pray this together in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so here in July, we've been doing this project, if you will, in our sermon times, where we're trying to figure out what it means to be a nation, one nation under God. Freedom is something that we've been talking quite a lot about. Freedom is sort of that driving force, that driving philosophy, that primary motivator that we all learned in school was part and parcel of that American Revolution that took place in the 1770s. It is said that Americans are freedom-loving people, but oftentimes that is taken to mean I can do whatever I want, and we get this kind of behavior. I can indulge every impulse to the nth degree as much as I want. Now, more positively, we might think of freedom to be the right to self-determination, and I think that's pretty good, but freedom is far more than that. It's more than just this philosophy of self-determination. Freedom is a gift, and Jesus teaches that here in the Gospel of John at verse 8. He's talking about the slavery that we are so prone to, the slavery to sin, but when the Son sets you free from your sin, you are free indeed. And so Jesus is revealing to us what's written into the very fabric, not just of our nation, but of creation itself, that we are a people whom God has loved, whom God has set free, whom God has given salvation to. And apart from him, we are slaves to sin. And our founding fathers knew this. This is these things are foundational truths that are written into the fabric, again, not just of our nation and not just of our creation, but of our own hearts. Our founding fathers knew that these things are unalterable and self-evident, that all people, all men, the founder said, are created equal. They are equally loved. They are equally valued by God. And their value comes not from society or from culture or really indeed from government, but from being human beings who are beautifully, wonderfully, fearfully created in the image of God and are given, are offered salvation by that one true God, that they are endowed by their Creator with these things. Now, we are Americans and we talk about these things in our founding documents. And we should know that these things are not simply a handout. And just because we were born on this soil or we came to this place, that these things are just handed out willy-nilly and that we can take them or leave them as we want. As Americans, we are individuals and we are communities. We are a nation that are given the space and the freedom and the personal responsibility to grow these things in this soil, to provide for and protect our prosperity and our progeny, and to give these things to each other, to protect each other in this way, that we together might flourish and prosper. And all of this, of course, is for that larger purpose that can be found in the preamble of the Constitution. And that we ordain and establish these things on this soil as this nation, as the United States of America. Now, these things are a code of conduct. They are an ethical pattern of community and civility that is taught not simply in the Constitution, but in the foundation on which the Constitution is built, and that is on the teachings of the Bible. And there is no other code of conduct, no other framework of ethics that surpasses the Bible in this regard, because we even see these things are written into the human heart. We know that murder is wrong. We know that lying is wrong. We know that stealing is wrong. It's somehow written into the very fiber of our being, into our DNA. And so we discover that this biblical faith is the faith on which the first generations of Americans built this country. And these values are taught by this faith. And forgetting this faith will be our undoing. Remembering this faith, this Jesus faith, this biblical faith is our strength. Now, what does it mean to be a nation made to receive and deliver these blessings from God and deliver them to the world? We have been trying to examine here in the month of July what this means, that there in fact may be nations across the span of human history who have endeavored to do this. Americans are not special in this regard. You know, we have taken a poke at it and have at various times done well and at various times have forgotten how to do it. But there is one nation in the history of the human race, testified to in the Bible, that has been blessed to be a blessing. And that, of course, is the nation of Israel. They started out as this conglomeration of 12 families who became a nation. And how is it that they, Israel, during the time of the Bible, how are they in relationship with God? How did they grow to be a nation that was, if you will, one nation under God? What do we learn from Israel in the biblical era that we can apply to our own nation, to our own time? And we have been teasing out three themes in particular. Last week we talked about covenant. Today we're going to talk about holiness. What does holiness mean? And next week we're going to talk about sacrifice. Just a bit of a reminder from Genesis chapter 12, we started thinking about Abraham. Abram, who becomes Abraham, is promised by God that his offspring will become a great nation. I will bless you, and you will be blessed that you will be a blessing to the world. And over the course of the time, Abraham fathers Isaac, and Isaac fathers Jacob, and Jacob's name becomes Israel. And many years later, the families after Jacob, through their time of slavery in Egypt, come out of Egypt under the leadership of Moses. And in the transition from slavery in Egypt to living in the promised land, they are given a law. Their sort of moral fiber is reoriented out of the slavery orientation into the freedom orientation. The freedom to be God's people, to make choices for themselves to be God's people. And of course, they enter into the promised land under the leadership of Joshua, and there they become a nation. 600 years or so, that process that I have described to you in a few sentences took place. And here we are in July of 2023, and the United States is about 247 years old. And we take a comparison of those two frames of time, and we recognize God is not done with us yet. God is not done with us yet. And so we must not give up on the process that God is drawing us as his people through. As a nation, we must remember and renew the covenant that we have together. And we talked about covenant quite a bit last time. We talked about covenant in terms of the individual relationship that you and I have with the Lord. You are a son, you are a daughter of God. You have an individual relationship with the Lord, and that's a covenantal relationship. You are in partnership, you, yourself, with the Lord. But we also have to recognize that that is a corporate thing as well. It happens in couples who are married. It comes in families. It comes in neighborhoods. It comes in nations. That all of these communities of the various kinds that you and I are part of, these are also potential places for covenant with God. And last week we were reminded of all the ways in which the agricultural theme happens in the Bible, where they're sowing and planting and so on. Those are good analogies for us to understand that God's people are called to plant and tend and harvest, certainly in the ground so that we might feed ourselves, but the fruit of things like justice and kindness and compassion and faith, those are not cultivated from the ground. They are cultivated from communities. That groups of people are the places where these things are sown and tended and nurtured and watered and weeded. And those fruit are born. And so when we encounter difficulty in the world where these things seem to be threatening, we have to make sure that we don't shake our fist at God for those things, because God has called us into covenant partnership to tend these things. And we have to set aside personal agendas and self-interest and identity politics in order to grow the peace and civility that a nation is called to by God's word. And so we as the church are God's covenant people who are primarily called to foster these things in the world. God has given this job to no one else. And so when we say, we the people, in order to form a more perfect union, we the people, right? Okay. Today, we read again from Exodus chapter 19, and I hope those words sound familiar because we have read them recently already, but this is that spot again where the nation of Israel is called to holiness, and that is where we're focusing our attention now. The nation chosen by God is set apart for God's purposes. They are God's treasured possessions among all of the peoples. You see that right there about the middle of the slide. And so the earth itself belongs to the Lord. The earth is mine, we read here in Exodus chapter 19. And he has a plan for it. That plan involves his people being a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Let's think about those two phrases for a moment. Being a priest means that the person who is the priest stands on behalf of God to the people. The priest speaks what God has said to the people. But that is also a two-way street. The priest also goes to God on behalf of the people. Now, to say that the priest is a middleman is, you know, true. We get that, and we in the Protestant tradition tend to eschew the word priest because as your pastor, you go directly to God. We together are linking up arms to come before the Lord together. And so I'm not your middleman in any way, shape, or form. We are all on the same footing before the Lord. But we also have to recognize that in the case of Israel, there is this, Israel itself stands as a conduit for the communication of God's purposes to the people of the earth. And we will discover in the person of Jesus, who is a son of Israel, that he goes on behalf of the Lord for us. So the nation of Israel is set apart for this purpose. And this set apartness is what it means to be holy. They are a holy nation because it is through the nation of Israel that God's love and mercy and purposes are made known to the world. And this ultimately happens, of course, through the Israelite known as Jesus, the Messiah of God, who has come to save you and me, who are not born of Israel. We don't have, well, some of us might, but most of us here in this room do not have Jewish DNA in us. So when we read about this in the New Testament, of course, I've skipped many verses. Here we go. When we read of this in the New Testament, we get to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. Let me read this for you now. Therefore, prepare your minds for action, being sober-minded. Set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in your conduct, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And so in Jesus, we are God's people. Therefore, we are called to be holy like God is holy. What does this mean? Now, there is some confusion because, there's a cultural view of holiness. And so as a little experiment, I was like, plug it into a Google image search. What does it mean to be holy? Holy people. And so these are some of the images that come up when you do a Google image search of holiness. There's all of this sort of paraphernalia there you see there. Or in a more Eastern way, this being a holy person. Lots of face paint. I'm not exactly sure what that means. Maybe Sam and Hannah could teach us a little bit about that. Or Mother Teresa, right? You know, sort of the queen of holiness in the sort of the modern era. Or there's also this holier than thou kind of thing where someone's thumping their Bible and pointing out where you have broken the law. And so these are kind of the cultural images of what it means to be a holy person. Now, it might surprise some that this is not what holiness means. Holiness does not mean becoming a monk or a nun, putting on a habit or doing these kinds of things, or even thumping your Bible at people. It is mistakenly descriptive of someone who lives a life deprived of pleasure or isolated from the trappings of the world. To live with God is to recognize that He grants us the pleasures of life to be enjoyed as He intends them. And so the life of a child of God is not meant to be ascetic. It's not to be monk-like or to be lived in a convent, although some people are called to that kind of life for sure. But God bestows upon His children music to express beauty and to drink deeply of that. He's given us sport to exercise the bodies that He has given us. He has given wine to be enjoyed in moderation. He has given the pleasure of sex to be enjoyed in marriage. And so we are called to drink rightly and deeply of these gifts that God has given. But the other reality that we learn in Scripture is that humans, not being God, are inescapably prone to sin. And that truth means that we do not seek perfection in order to be holy. We seek faithfulness and forgiveness of our sin. Our sin does not disqualify us from the holiness that God calls us to. So, if holiness is not perfection, what is it then? Well, we've talked a little bit about that already, but the Apostle Peter starts in the second chapter of his letter by recognizing some of the sinful realities that we are prone to, and that we are called to put away malice or anger, deceit, lies, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. We are called to put these things away. He recognizes with us and for us to remind us that these are the things that we are prone to in our sinfulness, but that in Jesus we begin a new life where these things are, we are learning to set these things aside. We are born again. We are being strengthened to set these things aside as we drink of a new spiritual milk, as we taste and see that the Lord is good. His word, His spiritual milk strengthens us and corrects our minds, orients our vision to see these things. His goodness begins to strengthen our lives for a new purpose. And that purpose is not self-protection. It's not self-promotion as taught by the world, its society, its culture. You see, the world rejects that way of living. I think that's in the next slide. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own perfection, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who called you out of your former darkness and into His marvelous light. And so as you come to Him, you are being built into something more solid and set apart from the world. It is distinct and different. And this new way recognizes the way that the ways of the world dissipate and dilute us. Holiness in humans will not be perfection, but it will grow to be more and more day by day into the image of Jesus Christ. The world may stumble because of this, but you are to obey. You are this royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. Now, two other little spots in the Gospels I'd like to share with you to maybe unpack this idea of what it means to be a holy nation. We are a group of people who are indeed called to holiness, this set apartness, but we have lost, it seems to me, our national mooring on the foundation of Scripture. We find ourselves now this day awash in a million personal fantasies that we are somehow supposed to be beholden to, whatever identity, regardless of how juvenile or dangerous we must allow or even respect or even teach that stuff to our kids. Heaven forbid that stuff. Like Jesus and Peter encourage holiness in his letter, we also need to identify that which is unholy among us. Peter does it. He said, put that stuff away. We have to see it, and we have to encourage the putting away of that stuff. Now, this may feel like judgmentalism to many. This might sound ironic, but we are indeed called to judge. We have to be able to identify what slander is, what that stuff is that Peter was just talking about, slander and anger and deceit and those sorts of things. To see that behavior is to judge it for what it is. Now, when Jesus says, judge not lest you be judged, as he does here in Matthew 7, we have to recognize something very carefully. Here in verse 3, why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but not notice the log in your own? It's not to ignore that speck, but it's also to go through this profound self-evaluation to be able to see the sin in our own lives, that log sticking out of our eyeball, and to remove it in confession and repentance so that we might together help each other see those specks and to remove them. Not to ignore them, but only after you have been able to have this confession and repentance that in verse 4 we can say, let me take that speck out of your eye. The judgment that Jesus is warning us about is to condemn each other to hell. Friends, when you get to heaven someday, you're going to be surprised at who's there. You would have never thought that, oh, you're there. Awesome. Because we often get this part wrong. We are never to say, you're going to hell for that. That is the wrong motivation in order to do this speck thing that Jesus is talking about. So here is just another spot in John chapter 8 where I think this begins to make a little more sense. Before these couple of verses, the Pharisees, these religious authorities who were so good at saying, you're going to hell, they were the ones who probably entrapped this poor woman in the act of adultery. They probably had all visited her and knew where she was, right? Anyway, she's in the midst of the act, and so they haul her out of the act and they put her right before Jesus. And they say, Jesus, what should we do? This woman has been caught in the very act of adultery. And of course, they're all thinking that the punishment for this is to be stoned, that she would be judged and condemned right there. And so Jesus then begins to draw on the ground. You know, he's doing this weird thing where they're all like, what is he writing? And meanwhile, this woman is probably trying to cover herself up. And Jesus says, the one among you who is without sin, you cast the first stone. And I imagine there was this profound silence. When they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before them. And Jesus stood up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? She said, no one, Lord. Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more. This is the holiness we are called to. With compassion and kindness, with forgiveness and the call to repentance, we refine our behavior so that it reflects more and more what it means to be the sons and daughters of God. This is the holiness we need for the nation. We're not looking for simply a more conservative version of the United States of America in a political or economic way. That, you know, there's probably some benefits to those kinds of things, but that's not the goal. The goal is that we would be people who mercifully seek the best version of ourselves, the sons and daughters that God has made us to be. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thanks for today, and we ask, Lord, today that we might understand this holiness and what it would mean that we as America and our sister nations across the face of the earth, that we would be one nation under God, living in covenant life with you and in holiness. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Having heard the message today, we're going to follow with a song called Trust and Obey. It's not in your hymnals. It is going to be up on the screen in a moment. There we go. And I invite you to stand with me and let's respond with this song. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt or a fear, not a sigh or a tear can mourn while we trust and obey.
Trust and obey,
for there's no other but to trust and obey. And in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says He will do, what He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Friends, in your bulletin, you'll see our affirmation of faith, this condensation about the sovereignty of God for us. Let's say these words together. Having lost true freedom of will in the fall, we are incapable of turning toward God of our own volition. God chooses us for Himself in grace before the foundation of the world, not because of any merit on our part, but only because of His love and mercy. Each of us is chosen in Christ, our brother and our high priest. He is our divine helper, who is also bridegroom, sharing our human nature so that we may see His glory. We who receive Him and believe in His name do so not by our own will or wisdom, but because His glory compels us irresistibly to turn toward Him. We are sinners who fall short of God's glory, and we all deserve God's eternal judgment. Apart from the saving work of Jesus Christ, we are incapable of being in God's presence, incapable of bearing the weight of His glory. We rejoice that Jesus Christ offers us safe conduct into the heart of God's consuming and purifying fire, shielding us with His perfect humanity and transforming us by His divine power. having received such grace, we extend grace to others. Thank you, friends. Please be seated. Okay, let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time together. We thank you for the call that you have upon our lives for holiness. We ask, Lord, that we might recognize the ways in which we have compromised our holiness by seeking our self-centered ways. But Lord, today we recognize that you call us to be refined by your holy fire, that in the holiness you call us to, that we would be set apart to live as a light that shines in the darkness, that mirror that reflects your glory into the world. And so, Lord, may that be true for us more and more each day. We ask, Lord, today that you would continue to be with Doug's friend Vicky, as after her accident, her neck is now slowly healing. Just bring strength to those bones, we pray. We thank you, Lord, for church mission trip opportunities like the one that Doug enthusiastically spoke about here, about revival happening in Bath, Maine, and ask, Lord, that as churches support one another, that we might encourage that living of faith more enthusiastically in one another. And we do pray, Lord, for our mission trip with Samaritan's Purse in this regard, that we'd be more than carpenters, but that we would be a beautiful reflection for one another of Jesus Christ. We ask, Lord, today that you would be with the Stocktons today after all of the activity of memorial services and so on. Now, Lord, there is that deep breath and that looking forward to the next phase of life for them. We thank you, Lord, for the great faith of that entire family that knows that as their loved ones pass away, that they are just moving on to the next phase of triumphant life, lived fully in your presence. How wonderful that is, Lord. So, Lord, be with us now and be with the Stocktons in their grief. Lord, hear our prayer now in this time of silence. We release to your care the things that burden us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for hearing our prayer. And we pray this as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing. Again, this hymn is only on the screen today, On Eagle's Wings. Let's stand and sing.
Who dwell in the shelter of the Lord, who abide.
not fear.
You need not fear the terror of the night,
not the arrow that flies by day.
Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Please be seated for just a moment as we think about some of the ministry announcements that are coming up. Peanut butter is continuing to be collected for CD NutriPacks. There's a bin by the coffee. If you'd like a moment of prayer right after worship, I'll be happy to meet with you. So come on up and we can talk or pray or whatever is on your heart. Mission trip luncheon is right after. And so even if you didn't sign up, I bet there's probably a sandwich for you. So come on along and join us and you'll hear about what our mission team will be doing in Western Kentucky with Samaritan's Purse. Men's breakfast is coming up on the 19th. That is Wednesday? Tuesday. Wednesday. Wednesday morning, the 19th at Peachtree on Progress at 9 a.m. There's the luncheon. Summer fellowship is this week, on July the 19th. I'm going to have two meals fed to me that day, although one of them I have to cook, right? That's right. So just a time of back deck fellowship, a burger and a hot dog and whatever else you bring, and some music and prayer and reflection. So come on out for summer fellowship. At Wellsville on Saturday the 5th, we'll hear from Sweet Life Music. So let's support the developing of sort of small groups in Wellsville with the hope of becoming a worshiping community there, and that's at 6:30, and youth fellowship on the 27th, 6:30, and that's all I have. Yes, go ahead.
Our granddaughter Olivia went off to boot camp.
Yep.
And she's looking hot, gorgeous. But as she had 10 friends that came over to her house, and as she was getting on the bus with the recruiter, they all stood at attention and said the pledge of allegiance.
Oh, how nice.
And I think that's wonderful. You don't hear good things about this anymore.
That's a beautiful testimony. Thank you for sharing that. Any other announcements that I've missed? Oh, yes, I forgot about that. We have our new Road to Emmaus t-shirts that are available to you today. $15 suggested donation. And so there'll be a box and a basket out in the gathering area before too long today if you'd like to pick one of those up. Let's stand. If you'd extend your hands forward to receive this blessing and benediction, may the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to him be all glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, go in peace.